Ladies and gentlemen, come gather around, come gather around, come gather around. Today, we're going to be pulling the transmission out of this truck. Again, because why not? And just for kicks and giggles, my voice is not here, so you get the voiceover. Let's go! All right. There are a few things I hate more in life than pulling transmissions, so I'm just going to work fast and try and get it over with in a quick like sort of hurry. Probably one of the best things I did was buy a hoist. Mind you, the hoist got its first use when I grenaded this transmission. Oh man, I don't remember. 5 years ago? 4 years ago? 5 years ago? I guess that first transmission rebuild was pricey, but anyways, here we are. The nice thing about these older vehicles is everything comes out pretty easy. Everything's relatively easy to get to. It's like they intended this thing to be service friendly. And like I tell all my students, buy yourself a half-ton Chevy pickup. There is nothing cheaper. You buy more parts, but they're cheap parts too. Up in the engine bay, I disconnected the throttle detent cable. It just tells the transmission to downshift when you're in full throttle. Also, I believe it changes the line pressure as well. This transmission has some drive, like vibration issues, and it's just getting worse and worse and worse and worse. For ever since I bought this truck, it kind of did the Hippy-Shake-Shake at 80 kilometers an hour. It would be smooth up to, and then right around 76 K to 83 K, the back of the truck just kind of did the Hippy-Shake-Shake, and then it would go away. But then it had this kind of growly noise that would happen on partial throttle and coast, and then the vibration was getting worse on the highway, and I've been chasing vibration for freaking years. I tried pinion shims, drive shaft, truing the drive shaft, different U-joints, oh my gosh. However, when I smoked the transmission, I never checked the end play out of the transmission. And then about a couple of years after rebuilding it, I took it all apart, checked the end play, shimmed it all up to the proper end play, and it was better, but now it's bad again. So, in this case, I'm going through the whole thing, but I'm also changing some stuff that I'm not happy with. I got the whole valve body out. This has a Transgo Stage 2 shift kit in it. I'm going to be unshift-kitting the shift kit and replacing all of the thrust bearings inside. And I'm also going to replace the case because there's some issues with this case I'm not happy with. One of which is in the comedy of reassembling the transmission 5 or 6 years ago. I stripped some of the pump bolts and I put helicoils in, but I think I screwed it up, so whatever. I'm just taking the whole thing apart, blitzing away. And there are lots of videos on turbo 350 transmissions. This nasty looking blue case is one I've been carting around on a shelf for years. It was mocked up in the V8 Firefly. Check the link above to follow some of the videos we did on the V8 Firefly. V8 Chevy Sprint for you guys in America. And V8 Suzuki Swift for everybody abroad. We're going through the transmission, cleaning the snot out of it and getting ready to go. This one was actually in pretty good shape. Except for this part. This is the output ring gear on the crusty blue transmission, which is not a lot of play. It's only held on with a snap ring. And I don't know if this is an issue or not, but mine, which has a longer tail shaft, has this gargantuan amount of play that I'm not happy with. So I scooped the ring gear off of the blue transmission, put it on my output shaft, and I had a happier level of end play. The lower reversed clutch piston gets put in place, bunch of springs. I made a fancy tool to help compress this retainer and put a snap ring in. You can buy them. I make them. And then the low reverse clutch goes in. All of this was new when I did the transmission. New thrust bearings. Any bushings that looked suspect, I replaced with new bushings. And I think the hub of one of these looked kind of sketchy. This has a cool heavy-duty center support, which uses a wide or low-roller clutch. The low-roller is one of the things that grenades. If you're ever gumbooting in your vehicle or trying to pull somebody out of the ditch or doing a hazer in front of your ex-girlfriend's place, if you're doing that in drive and starting off in drive one, all the power is held by this roller clutch. So it's in your best interest to change things. Here it looks like I got some hard shifting damage, but the forward clutch doesn't shift, so I'm not sure how it did that. However, I reused it, because why not? New bushing in there. Some of the thrust bushings in this transmission were plastic. I replaced them with brand new metal ones. In taking out the shift kit and dual feeding direct, you got to remove a seal inside the piston. And inside here, one of these clutches is just knackered. So I stole one out of the blue transmission and put it all back together. We're going to pull out the piston. We're going to take out the center seal. GM uses half of this piston for drive and or third and half of the piston for reverse. By dual feeding, you can use the whole surface area of the piston and double or triple the clamping force on your clutch. And part of that means picking out and removing this center seal. The shift kits often do this externally, but I've built transmissions with the shift kit and I built transmissions with internal mods. The internal mod is definitely well worth it. So we carefully put the piston back in, put in a replacement clutch from the one that's tacoed, stack her all together, and the direct clutch is done, ready to go. Not replacing any of the frictions. The tooth ring on there is an intermediate sprag. That's another part that grenades when it shifts into second gear. That's a weird wear, eh? Kind of says like you've been vibrating. It's kind of how I look when I've been vibrating. Replacing the direct drum bushing, which is a piece of festering poo, and mine looks nasty. Some of the Turbo 350s come with a narrow drum bushing, but I went and bought the wider ones, and usually that's the one you want to install. Then we put in the direct and forward clutch drum assembly in there. Then we got the intermediate clutch, which goes in. I did a little bit extra and added... I took a low reverse friction, scraped it down to just be steel, and put it in behind the piston of the intermediate apply. I think I show pictures of that. I don't think I show pictures of that. Second thing you want to do with dual feeding third or direct is this hole right here is going to get threaded for a 3/8 coarse set screw. And you're just going to tap it deep enough that the set screw can sit below flush. Or flush, but you don't want to tap it all the way through. You want to let it be tapered at the bottom so the set screw can seal at the bottom of the hole and stop anything from getting through. A smart cookie would do this before assembly, but apparently I've got the IQ of a bran muffin and didn't think of doing this in advance. Lucky me. It's got a filter. What's aluminum shavings going to do? I will use some compressed air and blow all that stuff out into somewhere else, because safety first. Then we put in the set screw, and you just thread her all in, and boom. This stops some of the application of fluid so that you can feed both halves of the direct clutch. Definitely worth it. There's one other modification we're going to do on the pump, but that's coming up a bit later on. So we'll pack all this stuff back in there again. What'd I do? Wait, no. There we go. Do it. Come on. Stay on target. Intermediate clutch. I think we've been here before. I think I forgot about this and then went back to do it. We're going to check the end play. So I'm taking all of the seals off of here. And we're going to set it into place with the pump gasket, but no O-ring around the outside. And we're going to check the end play. This thing seems to be excessive. And then we're going to throw a bunch of shims in there. And my math doesn't work, but when I was done, I ended up with a perfect 0.005 thousandths end play, which is on the tight end of end play for a Turbo 350. Recommended to be there. These are really fussy when they get too much end play. So we checked all the end play, then I put the seals in, and then the third part of the dual feeding, don't put the second seal from the bottom in. That also reroutes fluid and makes this happen. So your shift kit to get this thing super skookum really consists of a 3/8 coarse set screw and a drill. I'm going to use one of the drills right here. Here you can see the extra plate welded to the Transgo separator on the left. And I've got another Transgo separator that doesn't have the dual feed option, and I drilled some holes. You don't want to go super aggressive on drilling the holes, a bit massive. So we're putting it all back together, which is kind of the boring part. I recommend looking through books and seeing what the book tells you to do. I like reference books. Not everybody knows everything, and the interweb sure seems to think that they do. Nice thing about YouTube videos such as mine, it's really just my opinion. Hooray, hurrah. So, this little piece applies the intermediate band. Gasket, separator plate that I drilled holes into, another gasket. The valve body I didn't do anything to. It has had a couple springs changed, a pressure regulator spring and a 2-3 shift valve spring changed that came in the Transgo shift kit. But I didn't, I just took the valve body off, put it in a Ziploc, did what I needed to do, and I put the valve body back on. There was no need to take it apart. We got the screen filters. I've used the paper type filter, but screen ones seem to be the most recommended for these. Got the detent cable attached. Making sure it shifts into all the gears properly. And then we can button this thing all up and start putting her all back together in a moment. Cork gaskets are recommended for sealing the best. I've also carefully flattened the flange of this transmission pan. I debated painting the whole thing and making it all nice, gorgeous, one color. But the problem with multiple colors, it looks like a playground and looks pretty trashed. This crazy thing on the side cushions the application of second gear or intermediate, and then torque a whole bunch of times because gaskets are like that. If you like the transmission stand, I'll leave a link in the description below to a set of plans where you can build your own. I've made quite a few transmission stands. This one is my favorite. And then we'll put the whole thing back together. Lucky, lucky me. Good times. I have an X-pipe in the exhaust. In theory, the X-pipe gives you a better horsepower and a much smoother exhaust note. When these finally rot out, I will probably go to an H-pipe or true duals just to make it a little bit more ragged at idle, because it is a pretty ragged idle. It's just mellowed by this particular exhaust system. I'll probably hate it as soon as I do it because I'm not 16 anymore. I got one foot in the grave and the other on a banana peel. So, getting the transmission all set up, this stupid cross member that's a joy and a delight to put in. And I have a rubber trans mount at the back. I've run poly before, but poly tends to transmit all kinds of vibration into the rest of the truck. The cab mounts were the worst. I don't think I would do that. I'd go back to rubber. This is the third drive shaft I've had done for this truck, chasing vibrations. I did the oil change at the same time because why not kill two stones with one bird? I'm running 1540 diesel oil and a half liter of break-in fluid because I got a flat tappet cam with heavy-duty valve springs. Some people say break-in oil makes the thing wear in faster, and I think you're mistaken. Break-in oil has the additives that have been removed from oils. Throw in about 4 liters of Dexron 2. Fire it up, check the fluid. I think I've got it running. Looks like I got the door open. You can see the smoke coming through because it is cold outside. Took it for a drive, come back, check the fluids, look for any leaks, and it should be dandy, dandy, dandy. And here you can kind of hear the bit of the exhaust note, potato, 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 the cooling fan. There it is. The whole thing works. Transmission, turbo 350, out, back in, hooray, hurrah, and that was 2 days of joy. Thanks for watching.